توكل على الله.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Good evening everybody and welcome in Human Society of Nephrology scientific program. Today we'll spoke about interesting issue, role of physical examination in early detection and early diagnosis and early referral of the vascular access problem. Regarding the type of vascular access for hemodialysis worldwide, we can notice in this diagram GCC area. Most of people in GCC are 50% in AV fistula, and about 5% to 10% in AVG, and about 40% of people in GCC in Birmingham, and Oman, one of the GCC countries. Regarding the type of the vascular axis, the amount, the time of the axis session determined due to. The second diagram, we can show also the GCC time of session. We can notice that in about 50% only of GCC people in dialysis dialyzed 4 hours, and 25% dialyzed 3.5 hours, and 25% dialyze 3 hours or less. And this is depend on the type of the vascular access. Regarding Kiduki 2019, strong recommendation in the vascular access physical examination should be done at least once per week by experience, a good experience nurse and doctor. And this is two sentence by Sir Edward Deming, he's engineering. He said, it is not enough to do your best. You must know what to do and not to do, and then do your best. And physical examination is considered is our best for our patient to early detection of the problem. As we know, we have most of our patients either with AV fistula or with Birmingham, and we'll start by physical examination of the AV fistula. We can show in the diagram the AV fistula mainly formed of two parts, inflow part and outflow part. The inflow part formed of three parts. It is a feeding artery and anastomotic site and juxtanastomosis. While the outflow part formed of the body of the fistula, اللي هي 8 to 10 centimeter after juxtanastomosis till the central vein. And the main part stuff working in it, in the unit, it is the outflow part. So we'll start physical examination by outflow part. Physical examination mainly formed by 5 things. Look, feeling, listening, arm elevation test, and pulse augmentation test. Yeah, but when we're doing physical examination, we should doing 5 things. Look, feeling, listening, arm elevation test, and pulse augmentation test. And don't forget, during looking, to search about 3 things. Signs of infection, Still syndrome, and aneurysm. As we see in this diagram, we should scientific nurse or professional nurse during examination and also the doctor to differentiate between stable and unstable aneurysm. We can notice this is a picture of unstable aneurysm. We can show it is depigmentation and shiny and stretched skin. And this is need urgent referral for vascular surgeons. And in the right side of the diagram, we can show in, we can notice the hand of the patient with Still syndrome. Still syndrome found due to the fistula is mega fistula or big fistula. Normal fistula, 70% of the blood transfer from the artery to the vein, and 30% go to the hand. If there is mega fistula or large vein, it will steal the blood and take more than 70% of the blood, and this is induced what is called Still syndrome. Still syndrome have four stages. Stage one, the patient no symptoms, and only we can signs of signs of Still syndrome, like hyperpulsatile feeding artery or outflow, as we'll see later. And stage two, it is pain in the hand during exercise or during the session. Stage three of Still syndrome, the patient have been at rest, and stage four, the patient have necrosis and ulcers. Stage one and stage two of Still syndrome, only observation, and stage three and stage four need urgent referral. Also, we can, by inspection in physical examination, found the signs of infection and inflammation. As we see in the bottom of the diagram, signs of infection and inflammation, it is redness or swelling or pus. And this is the definition of stenosis of the fistula by Kiduk guideline, and the lumen of the fistula decreased more than 50% by comparison the patent area of the fistula with the sclerotic area. The inflow segment, as we said, it is started from the feeding artery and anastomotic area and juxta-anastomotic area. And the outflow starting from the body of the fistula, 8 to 10 centimeter, it is the cannulation area, and 10 to tail to the central venous veins. And central vein started from the subclavian vein to the superior vena cava. We'll start by outflow lesion. Professional nurse we should doing after finished the looking, she was doing the feeling by pulsation and by thrill. When you found the hyperpulsatile area, juxta anastomosis, it means in the this is area followed by stenosis, or this area if not followed by stenosis, it means this is megafistula. This is the first item. The second item, over the sclerotic area, we suspected to found systolic thrill, strong thrill, and we suspected to found high-pitched sound or high-pitched bruit, lower systolic bruit. And after the sclerotic area, we asked the patient to elevate the arm, and we can found descended distal area to the sclerotic and flattened proximal area to the sclerotic. So as a summary, in the outflow lesion, we can below the stenosis found hyperpulsatile area, and at the sclerotic area, we can found a strong thrill and high pitched bruit. And after the sclerotic area, we can found descended distal area and the flattened proximal area by arm elevation test. And this is new issues called BESUS. BESUS mean physical examination, significant outflow stenosis, and this is new score to diagnose advanced stenotic area in the outflow. This score, low BESUS, excellent sensitivity and specificity, 92% and 86% regarding sensitivity and specificity. And in our opinion, treatment of asymptomatic BESUS is beneficial for the prevention of unexpected fistula thrombosis. Yani early detection of BESUS and early referral is better than waiting to patient deteriorated and we lost the fistula. BESUS formed used to diagnose more than 75% of the outflow stenosis. And as we said, in the over-sclerotic area, we can found strong thrill and high-pitched bruit. And distal to sclerotic area, distal, it means towards the arm. If towards the arm, we can found hyperpulsatile area and descended arm elevation test. And hyperpulsatile fistula, if not followed by sclerotic area, it means it is high axis flow or megafistula, or what is called toxic fistula. And this diagram showed comparison between a normal outflow segment and a sclerotic outflow segment. And we can notice in the strotic outflow segment, the distal area to the stenosis, hyperpulsatile. The area of stenosis have strong shrill and high-pitched bruit. Both stenosis, we can notice the F arm elevation test, it will be flattened, and distal to the stenosis, it will be descended. And this is a clinical finding associated with hyperpulsatile pulse. An arm elevation test, as we said, descended distal and flattened the proximal. Shrill will be a strong shrill above the stenotic area. Bruit will be high pitched bruit above the stenotic area. And also during session or after patient finished in the session, we can notice the prolonged bleeding and the frequent dialysis venous alarm. And if patient neglected, it will be developed aneurysm. And this is the patient's what is called the shrill bruit score. If the patient have continuous shrill, it will take 3 score. And if arm elevation test is positive, it will take 1. And if the score is high, it means in the, no stenosis. If the the score is low, it means it is vicious. If no shrill and the arm elevation test negative, it will shift to the bruit. If no critical, bruit auscultation, it is continuous. If no critical vicious, if systolic bruit only, it is critical vicious and the patient have more than 70% of stenosis and they need rapid or fast referral. This is called vicious score or shrill bruit score. As a summary of outflow physical examination to detect stenosis, if we have hyperpulsatile fistula, look for high pitched bruit, prolonged bleeding, frequent venous alarm, and high venous pressure. If there is, it is all are positive, it means refer the patient for the IR for fistulogram and maybe need BTA and stent. And if it is negative, you have a follow-up of the patient and continue physical examination as guidelines said every session or at least once a week. This is the first part of the lecture, how to detect stenosis by physical examination. Depend on the hyperpulsatile area before the stenotic area and strong thrill and high pitch bruit above the stenotic area and arm elevation test to detect descension distal to the stenosis and flattened proximal to the stenosis. And when the patient referred to the IR, we can notice in the diagram in the January, the patient have stenosis in the outflow area and BTA done, balloon angioplasty, and the patient in the third picture, post BTA, the stenotic area become beaten. And after 3 months in April, the stenotic area returned again. The second part of the lecture about how to detect the stenosis in the inflow segment. The inflow segment, as we said, it is formed of the feeding artery, anastomotic area, and juxtaanastomosis. As a very simple, it is depend on the pulse and shrill. If there is faint shrill and the faint pulse in the feeding area, it means in this is the signs of stenosis in the feeding area, either in the artery or the anastomotic area, or most commonly juxtaanastomosis. And also patient signs in the patient, we can found the machine alarm for venous and arterial. And patient have KT over V and urea reduction rate is low. And it is can effectively help diagnose inflow segment pathology. And this is inflow as we can show in the diagram. If bruit is low pitched and the shrill is faint, it is diagnosis of inflow stenosis. And we can also confirm this sclerosis by a pulse augmentation test. Pulse augmentation test depend on a pulsation transformed from the feeding artery to the outflow vein. And if we breathe in the outflow vein and examine the pulse shocks and anastomosis, if it is expected to be augmented if the inflow is beta. If no augmentation by stress on the vein, it means this is signs of inflow stenosis. So a pulse augmentation test is very important to diagnose inflow stenosis and dysfunction of the AV fistula. As a summary of this part. The etiological factor of faint thrill or faint pulse in the fistula, it is maybe due to cardiac problem. The patient have congestive heart failure or low ejection fraction, or maybe is a problem in the feeding artery, as we said, due to stenosis or atherosclerosis, or maybe due to problem in the anastomotic area or juxta anastomosis due to stenosis. Yeah, but this is causes of stenotic inflow, and we can divide the patient in two groups, a group of new fistula, a follow-up of maturation in the first 6 weeks post surgery, and in old AV fistula. How we can detect the inflow stenosis in the new AV fistula? We can detect by a pulse augmentation test. If pulse augmentation test is positive, it is good fistula, good inflow. If pulse augmentation test is negative, it is suspected to be have stenotic inflow fistula. So this is the rule of physical examination for early detection of the inflow stenosis in the new AV fistula. A new AV fistula, we still not working. We still not put needling. We depend only on the physical examination, and also we can diagnose by ultrasound and angiography. By ultrasound, if we have a Doppler ultrasound in the unit, we can examine by BMOD diameter of the vein. If this fistula is mature, we suspected the diameter of the vein is 4 or more centimeter, millimeter. And we can examine volume flow. If the volume flow is more than 400 milli per minute, it means this fistula is mature and ready for working. If by physical examination or by ultrasound, it is the signs of immature, we send the patient for angiography or fistulography early to detect the stenotic area. And this diagram showing how we diagnose inflow stenosis in the early 6 weeks post operation by a pulse augmentation test, as we said. If it is established or AV fistula old, also we can complete physical examination of established AV fistula by doing a pulse augmentation test also. And we can see the diagram. If pulse augmentation test is positive, and the patient have adequate KT over V and adequate blood flow and arterial pressure is less than minus 200, it is a good fistula and continue monitor or physical examination. But if pulse augmentation test is negative and the patient has low adequacy, low urea reduction rate, low or high arterial pressure more than minus 200 or decreased blood flow, it means this patient need to early referral for fistulogram and duplex ultrasound. This is the second part of the lecture, how to diagnose the inflow. As a summary, by physical examination, we can examine, we can detect the outflow stenosis by hyperpulsatile area, followed by stenotic area, have a strong thrill and high-pitched bruit, and by arm elevation test, distal to the stenosis, we found flattened area. We can found descended area and post stenotic, we can found flattened area. And regarding the inflow stenosis, we can examine for faint shrill or faint pulse and negative pulse augmentation test, all of these diagnosis of inflow stenosis. The third part of the lecture, how we use physical examination and detect the problems of Birmikas. As we said, the Birmikas, about 30 to 40% of our units in Oman, the patient have Birmikas. For example, the data of Muscat area, we have about 700 patients on dialysis. 180 patients on Birmikas and about 500 patients on Evifistor. So examination and the detection of early dysfunction of the Birmikas is very, very important. We assessment of Birmikas by 4 points, the same looking for inspection and assessment for patency and assessment in dysfunction of the Birmikas and at the end assessment of Birmikas during the hemodialysis session. This is the first step for assessment of the Birmikas by visual inspection. When we assessment the Birmikas, we search about 2 points. The first point is the signs of infection, and the second point is early signs of dysfunction. Regarding early signs of infection, when the nurse removes the cover of the Birmikas, she should look for the exit sign. If she found redness, discharge, swelling, bleeding, or tenderness, it is all signs of exit site infection and should inform the physician. Also, we should visualize the collateral veins in the chest. This is the early signs of central venous systems. If a by look, we can diagnose early dysfunction of the Birmikas by central venous stenosis by collateral veins in the chest, as in this diagram. This is the collateral veins in chest, and we can notice the patient have ipsilateral swelling in the arm. And also we can signs that we can search about the signs of infection in the exit site. The second step in assessment of the Birmikas is the patency of the Birmikas. Every nurse doing 3 steps when before starting the dialysis session by Birmikas. First step, lay aspirate the anticoagulant look. And the second step, lay aspirate blood to notice there is clotting or not clotting. And third step, infusion of 20 ml of saline in each lumen to show the patency of the lumen. If any step of infusion or aspiration have a problem, it means this Birmikas have early dysfunction. Okay. The third point of assessment of the Birmikas is assessment of dysfunction. This dysfunction of the Birmikas mainly by 2 causes. The first cause is central venous stenosis, and the second cause is thrombosis. This is for the old Birmikas. Like if it is new Birmikas, maybe early dysfunction by kinking or by malposition of the tip of the catheter. When patient came with Birmikas, we divided the patient 2 groups. A patient in the early area of Birmikas insertion and patient with old Birmikas. In the early area of the Birmikas insertion, if there is dysfunction, in inspiration and infusion not working well, it means there is mechanical problem, either kinking or malposition of the tip of the Birmikas. If it is old Birmikas and have early, there is dysfunction symptoms and signs, we search about central venous stenosis or thrombosis. It is clear? Okay. This is the forms of position of the tip of the Birmikas. The ideal tip should be the arterial part medial and the venous part of the tip lateral, as we said, and there is no kinking in the left side of the diagram bottom. This is the ideal form of the ideal tip of the Bermicase tip should be in the mid right atrium, and the arterial line toward the medium, and the venous tip toward the lateral. And this is, we can detect the tip of the Bermicase also by two ways, by measuring from the notch of the sternal angle to the Zeff sternum and detect the midway between them, or by يعني easy method اللي هو in male بيبقى opposite to the nipple and in the female above to the nipple. And this is a form of kinking in new Bermicase and can be corrected early. And a well functioning tunnel catheter or Bermicase should have blood flow at least 3 milli per minute and 20 milli syringe filling in 4 seconds. Can Dr. Zaghloul in Egypt said it is what is called اللي هي الطف ان انت you can examine the Bermicase by putting syringe full of air and open the arterial line. If it is filling within 4 seconds, it is good Bermicase and not no kinking. And the second thing may be induced dysfunction of the Bermicase is the thrombosis. And the thrombosis take different form. We can see in this diagram. This is the types of thrombotic occlusion. Maybe intraluminal, maybe fibrin tail, maybe mural thrombus, يعني inside and outside, and at the end, maybe fibrin sheath. Regarding the fourth step, اللي هي assessment of the Bermicase during incision. During incision, if one of these signs appear, it means it, this Bermicase dysfunction and or dysfunction, and the please not lead to this Bermicase complete occluded. يعني this is early signs of dysfunction and there should be interference if you are in hospital or if you are in satellite unit, you can refer the patient to IR or to the tertiary hospital. Mechanical or machine related dysfunction signs, any blood flow decrease more than 10% of the basic observation, our blood flow bump less than 300. I think the most of our patients in the unit with Bermicase blood flow not reach to 300. Most of them from 200 to 250. Also, if there is high arterial pressure more than minus 250 or venous pressure more than 250 or urea reduction rate less than 65% and KIT over V less than 1.8 and frequent alarm during incision and the patient need frequent line reversal. All of these are early signs of Bermicase dysfunction. And also if the patient have pain or bleeding or have, as we said, central venous stenosis signs, collateral veins in the chest, all of these can early diagnose of the Bermicase dysfunction. How to manage the Bermicase dysfunction? We have medical management and mechanical management, and we want to notice the new notes of Kiduki guideline 2019 about the uses of alteplase. In the Kiduki guideline 26, they said in the use alteplase with low dose. While in the Kiduki guideline 2019, they said in the high dose of alteplase better than the low dose as in this study, the comparison between the high dose alteplase and low dose alteplase. And they found in the high dose of alteplase, it means 1 ml alteplase and bought saline regarding the length of the lumen, better than use of 0.5 ml of alteplase. And they found it is more patent for the patient and more Bermicase function in the future. So if in our units working by low dose Altiblaze, better to shift to high dose Altiblaze, 1 ml beside saline along the lumen of the Bermicase. Duration of Altiblaze very, very important. لأني البروتوكول of Basket guideline for Altiblaze can we wait 1 to 2 hours post Altiblaze, and this is not effective. And the most of patient not working the Bermicase after 2 hours. And guideline, they said, and maybe waiting from 4 hours up to 48 hours. And in SIB dialysis unit, we're doing a local guideline for Bermicase, and we collected the patient with dysfunction of Bermicase, and this is the last option for them. And we're doing Altiblaze look in the weekend. We bought 1 ml Altiblaze beside saline in the Altiblaze in the look for the Bermicase in the weekend. And the patient, or most of these patients, came in the Saturday or Sunday, and there is no problem in the Bermicase. And this is also present in the KDOQ guideline 2019. In the high-risk patient of Bermicase dysfunction, we can doing weekend Altiblaze block instead of heparin block or heparin block. Okay. The last thing in the, our lecture is the signs and symptoms of hemodialysis cluster-related infection. And we know there is exocyte infection, there is luminal infection, there is intraluminal infection, there is cluster-related bloodstream infection, and there is metastatic infection of the cluster-related. This is the exocyte infection, as we said. In the by physical examination, we can notice the erythema, the discharge, and it is can easily treated by a local antibiotic, and even can give the patient oral antibiotic. And the cluster tunnel infection, as we know, in the patient usually signs of infection appear during the hemodialysis due to backfiltration, and maybe the patient at home no signs of infection. Most of cluster-related infection appear during the hemodialysis. And don't forget the metastatic complication of the cluster-related osteomyelitis, endocarditis, and septic arthritis, and spinal epidural abscess. And we actually, during these 7 years of working in SIB, we have patient have osteomyelitis and endocarditis, and also septic arthritis as a complication of cluster-related bloodstream infection. Okay, and this is the last diagram in our lecture regarding announcement of the our international conference in Salalah, inshallah, next September from 7 to 9. And we asked all our colleagues, either nurse or doctors or pharmacist or other staff, to enter the site of Women's Society of Nephrology, and can see the detail of the conference. And this is my announcement of my lecture in the conference about the uses of doublex versus angiography in diagnosis and management of stenosis. And will be, inshallah, interesting lecture. Thank you.